Blackstone presents Black Marsh by Jean Heller. This book is read by Christine Lakin. In memory of Walter Satterthwaite, a dear friend, a supportive shoulder, and one of the great mystery writers of our time, you are missed, Walter. And as always, for Ray, always. This is a work of fiction. With the exception of some Chicago landmarks and commercial establishments, similarities to real people, places, and events are entirely coincidental. Chapter 1. Chicago. Night. The night began quietly enough in downtown Chicago, an area that encompassed the near north neighborhood above the Chicago River and the Loop south of the river. The Loop was so called because beneath Chicago's busy downtown streets lay a labyrinth of rail tracks. They carried commuter train lines into the center city, then looped around and went out again. The trains were known collectively as the L, because most ran almost entirely above ground on elevated tracks. Only in the Loop did they dive into the subterranean world. The Loop neighborhood boasted many of Chicago's finest restaurants, stores, and theaters. Michigan Avenue, nicknamed by the Chamber of Commerce as the Magnificent Mile, ran a straight north-south line down the middle of the city. Just to the west, Rush Street ran in a parallel line of some of the trendiest shopping east of Rodeo Drive in Beverly Hills. The area smelled of money and privilege. This night, it would smell of death. Chicago police training officer Louis Cassell and patrolman James Weldon had been touring the area since their shifts began 6 hours and 13 minutes earlier. Cassell drove. Weldon worked the radio. He had used it only 3 times since they came on duty, twice to check in and once to check out for lunch. Cassell had 8 years on the force. Weldon, fewer than 4 months. Cassell didn't much like the younger man. Weldon tended to talk too much and claimed to know too much. He had been assigned to ride with Cassell only 2 months out of the academy, after he and his first training officer had a falling out. His relationship with Cassell was moving in the same unhappy direction. Cassell was supposed to bring Weldon in line and smooth out his rough edges. He didn't feel that he was making much progress. Cassell didn't trust his young partner's judgment. The kid was prone to unnecessary violence, bad tactical decisions, and didn't take criticism well. Earlier in the evening, he had jumped out of the squad car at a traffic light and hassled a man waiting in a delivery-only zone for his girlfriend to get off work at the Crate and Barrel store on Michigan Avenue. The guy had stayed in his car with his flashers on and wasn't causing any problems. Nobody was delivering anything at that time of night. Weldon rapped hard enough with his nightstick on the driver's window that he might have broken it had Cassell not ordered him back to the squad car. Cassell asked the driver what he was doing, was satisfied with his answer, and told him to move on as soon as his girlfriend showed up. The two cops hadn't spoken to one another since. Cassell would file a report on the incident after shift. It was now moving past 3 a.m., and the squad car was patrolling a part of the near north side that made Cassell uneasy at night. Chestnut was a nice street. Upscale condos, restaurants, theaters, parks, Michigan Avenue and Rush Street, the Oak Street Beach, and Northwestern Memorial Hospital, all within walking distance. But the easternmost blocks that ended at Lakeshore Drive were badly lit, an open invitation to drug dealers, muggers, robbers, and carjackers operating in the gloom. The hour and the current weather conditions had swept most people off the streets. Winds off the still frigid waters of Lake Michigan fingered among the downtown buildings in search of pedestrians to harass. While the calendar said it was late May, thermometers said it was 42. The feels-like temperature was 38. Snow flurries swirled on the winds and melted as soon as they hit the ground. South of Chicago, spring was firmly entrenched, but in the city, winter refused to give up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.